Hi, good evening or good morning, good afternoon to all of you who've joined us today, wherever you are, on Zoom and Facebook and YouTube. Welcome to the seventh edition of the Urban Lens Film Festival. We've watched many films over the last 6 days and many wonderful conversations. And today is the closing conversation of the festival, which is Reflections on Cinematography, which is under the aegis of what we call On Practice. A brief introduction to the series On Practice. At the Urban Lens Film Festival over the years, we've had this On Practice series where we speak to film practitioners. And when I say film practitioners, they're not just directors, film directors, camera people, sound people, editors, to speak about their craft. And this is because film's a collaborative medium. We all know, those of us who make films, that a film doesn't get made because of one person, who is typically seen as the director, who in most film festivals or public platforms is the person who represents the film. But we felt that it was important to speak to practitioners. What does it mean to shoot? What does it mean to edit? What is the process? And get them to open up and speak about their body of work over time. And the other reason for it is also, is that you see very often, not always, but very often, it's filmmakers make the film and academics write about it. And while this is very important, academics and film critics do play a role and they must continue to. I think what we're also trying to do here is to say, is there a way that practitioners can actually reflect on their work and not just in some academic journal, but in a more public way. And that is also the endeavor of this series. And we hope we can bring out something around this in the near future. So as part of this is Reflections on Cinematography, and we have four wonderful cinematographers with us today who come from various forms of filming style and genres, and they will be in conversation with Sabina Gadiok. I'm going to introduce each of you to you in no particular order. We have Fawzia Fatima with us, who's a cinematographer who's evangelical about boosting women power in the medium of cinema, chiefly women technicians and women cinematographers in particular. In March 2015, she began the Facebook group Association of Indian Women Cinematographers and Women with other women DOPs. And many of the DOPs joined, and what came out of this is the Indian Women Cinematographers Collective, in a display of fantastic collective spirit, and on March 8, 2017. So this is Fawzia. Many of you would have actually seen Fawzia's works as well that have been shot, and in due course of the conversation, you'll get to hear more about her work. We have Maheen with us. Maheen Mirza is a cinematographer committed to cinema that is born of collective practice. Her work strives to challenge the grammar of commercial cinema and serves to nurture a culture of independent filmmaking. She's worked with several organizations and people's movement on socio-political and educational issues, and has made fiction and documentary films across the country. Some of the films that she shot is Jadui Machi and Turup, which we have screened here at IHS. And her latest work, Hotel Rahagir, is scheduled to release in December 2020. Welcome to both of you, Fawzia and Maheen. The third person on the panel is Priya Seth, who started her career in 1996 when cinematography wasn't even considered a profession for women across the world, let alone India. Priya has charted a unique path for herself, starting off her career shooting the much appreciated independent film Bara Ana to critically acclaimed work in the Hindi film Airlift. Priya has shown that gender is no bar to achieving excellence. Having made a mark as the foremost underwater cinematographer in the country, Priya continues to further the caliber of underwater work being done in India. She continues to inspire young women all over India to pursue unusual professions with passion and fearlessness. Welcome, Priya, and I'm very glad you do what you do. The fourth person on the panel is Savita Singh. Savita is a cinematographer and filmmaker based out of Mumbai, a 2007 cinematography graduate from the Film and Television Institute of India. She has, in the last 7 years in the film industry, worked with varying visual styles and formats. Some of the films that she shot and you would have seen are 404, Error Not Found, Funk, Doser, and Ventilator. She was also selected as scholar for the prestigious Budapest Cinematography Masterclass and had the great opportunity to learn under the guidance of master cinematographer Wilmos Zsigmond, She was also declared the Indian winner of 2007 for the prestigious Kodak Film School competition. Welcome, Savita. And they are all going to be in conversation with the wonderful Sabina Gadyuk, who we all know, who has also been a part of Urban Lens, and she has also been my teacher many, many years ago. So welcome, Sabina. It's really lovely to have you here. Sabina Gadyuk is professor at the AJK Mass Communication Research Center, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi, where she teaches digital media arts. She began her career as an independent documentary filmmaker and camera person. Her film, Three Women and a Camera, won two awards at Film South Asia and at the Mumbai International Film Festival. Sabina writes on Indian photo history, cinema, and popular visual culture, and has curated several photo shows. She was a curator of Lightworks, a retrospective of photographer Jitendra Arya at the NGMA Mumbai and Bangalore in 2017-18. She's also written a book on India's first woman press photographer, Homai Vyarawala, titled Camera Chronicles with Homai Vyarawala. This book came out in 2006. Many of you, I'm sure, would have read it. Gadyuk is a member of several advisory boards that includes the editorial board of the online journal Trans-Asia Photography Review. She's, of course, shot many, many films, including the documentary film Tale of the Night Fairies, directed by Shohini Ghosh, which was made in 2002. So very warm welcome to all of you. And we're really, really looking forward to this conversation. Over to you, Sabina.
Thank you so much, Subhashree. Can I be heard?
Yes, yes.
Okay, great. So thank you, Subhashree, and the Urban Lens Festival for inviting me to moderate this wonderful session. And I welcome this session on practice, as you yourself have said, because the focus is so often on what lies within the frame. But filmmaking, as we know, is such a collaborative process which involves so many different people, and the cinematographer is so integral to that process. I think that's very important. But I was also very happy to see the description of this session as a conversation between four cinematographers and not four women cinematographers. And I thought that was very important, because we never question the fact that when four men sit together and talk, we never call them four male, camera people. So I was happy to see that. I'm going to be very brief in the beginning. As someone who started, shooting on video in the late 80s, I just quickly want to signpost some anecdotes from my own experience, and which some of you may relate to and or may not, because hopefully things have changed for the better. First, as a student, when it was said that, we were the teacher's favorites when we got to do the 16mm camera. Later, when you started to work, you found work only with women. You found work who were willing to work with you and wanted to work with you. And I'm talking largely of nonfiction film, which is what I did. I didn't do any fiction, of doing women-centric projects, because what else can women do, of course? To be questioned, can you hold a steady shot with the tripod? I'm sure that's a question that creeps in even now. To be surrounded with advertisements of men holding big cameras, big men holding these cameras. And I'm thinking to myself, and I've always thought to myself, how many male camera persons do I know who are so big? And do you need that kind of strength to be able to hold a camera? I mean, if that was the case, then bodybuilders would be the best, cinematographers and camera persons. And of not, knowing, of not being able to see other women around me. And I do remember a very important moment for me when I was asked to go and do an interview with B.R. Vijayalakshmi, who was like this pioneer, who was one of the only women photographing at that time in Bangalore. And, how excited I was to be able to do this interview with her. But there are other affirmative stories too. Of the joy of traveling to places and dealing with experiences that I would never have experienced. And I'm sure that's something that all of you have felt, that I have ever dreamt of in my life, of feeling a strange kind of power when I hold the camera, of teaching technology to younger women, because I'm now a teacher, and of trying to kind of, unravel the fog that surrounds technology, because there's so much of fog that surrounds technology, and make it easier for women and for men, because, you know, for men too, you know, I mean, they are looked down upon if they admit to being technophobic. So I think that that was something which was very important for me, of the delight of watching, you know, the names of my own students at, on news channels and being described as camera persons, finally, and not being called cameramen. Of course, being able to enter spaces and, you know, be able to capture images, because you were so underestimated and so under the radar. But that's a story for later. This is not my story. This is a story about four very, very articulate, capable and creative camera women. And I welcome all of you today, Mahim Mirza, Priya Seth, Fauzia Fatima, and Savita Singh. So I'm going to start this conversation by taking you through questions, not again, as Subhashree said, not in any particular order, but I'm going to start with Savita, maybe two questions for each person, and then take a round of questions which all of you can answer. So Savita, I'm going to start with this whole debate between, you know, you did this, you know, your student film was highly acclaimed, Kramasha, and in 2007, and you shot it on film. And then, of course, there's been this whole debate on film versus, celluloid versus digital. And you tend to work a lot more now with your advertising work and your films on your fiction films on the digital. And of course, there's been this big debate with somebody like Christopher Nolan saying that I will never move to the digital. I'll always work on film, and, you know, holding on to that. And of course, you know, there are many other people who've moved and made that transition. So I was just wondering what you thought of that. And do you still how do you relate to the digital? And do you still have a sense of nostalgia for film? Would you like to still shoot on film?
Thank you so much. I'm so glad to be here. And that's a very interesting question. So back when I shot my diploma, which was in 2007, celluloid was still like the primary choice, because the digital cameras were not that good and they were just starting to come in the market. But later on, around 2013, 12, 14, it was the digital had kind of taken over. It was everywhere. And that was the time when the choice of digital versus film became you didn't have a choice. The digital was coming in. And back then, I remember I was really a Puritan and I loved film so much that I was not ready to shift. And I remember I shot a feature called Hawaii Zada, which was practically the last film that Kodak processed in Bombay before they shut their laboratory. So it was quite a struggle to, you know, keep requesting them to hold off, and the labs were shutting. So it was getting very difficult to shoot on film at that time. But digital has evolved for good, and it's really come up in a very good way, and it has a very good sensitivity. And plus, you have an advantage with digital now, like you don't have to worry about footage, or you don't have to worry about especially when you're shooting with non-actors or children. So I remember with stock, we had to be misers. So it's evolved beautifully. Of course, I would love to shoot on film for the nostalgia of it, like you correctly mentioned. And it's an evolved medium. And what film does, I think that organic quality of film, I think digital wouldn't have that for me ever. But I try and shoot stills on film, and that's how I kind of get by. But I think digital is doing great, and I really enjoy shooting on Alexa and the other cameras like Venice, and they're matching up. Okay. Yeah.
I just wanted to say that, you know, I'm asking the individual questions, if you have something that you just quickly want to kind of jump in and say, please feel free to do so. So, you know, I could see all of you looking at Savita. So if there's something you'd like to add, please go ahead. We will manage the time. Then if you like to add to that.
Yeah, certainly about the transition from film to digital. And that was a time when I was actually with the Satyajit Ray Film and Television Institute, and I was the head of Department of Cinematography. And I was actually holding on to that, you know, cans need to be processed and labs shutting down. I mean, it's interesting that, you know, matching up with film school, what was going on was the timeline was going haywire, and we didn't know when the stocks would get processed and get back. second, whether it will be clean and good processing, because the baths used to actually, the attention depleted, and so also the, you know, so many things, you know, dust in the frames, and all those things are happening, and the reality was hitting us actually that, you know, it's not going to be forever. I mean, it's going to happen very fast. So I remember the camera assessment series session happening in 2010 October, I think, in in Bombay, and it had this brought by the Producers Guild of America and ASC, American Society of Cinematographers, and they had made this entire package of comparison of film stock with different digital cameras at that time, you know, professional cameras. So 4-3-5 they had shot, I mean, sorry, on film, I think, stock was one I'm not remembering which camera, maybe Panavision it was, and compared to all the digital platforms that were available at that time, from Genesis to, you know, so, and this was projected and shown, I think Cinematographers Combined had, hosted that session, and I remember coming back from that, and that was the first time the Alexa was being introduced, and coming back to the campus and being very, it's just going to happen. It's there, and we have to be ready for it. It was so strong, the urge, that till then the idea was to pick up another 435. Sorry, I was thinking of 435 for the department at that point. And then after the session, it dropped, and it was kind of fully orienting to how do I get an Alexa into the department. And that was the whole shift. And I had been experimenting before. From 2005 onwards, when the first HDV camera had come out, Z1, and there were experimental film projects that I'd taken up, and I was constantly experimenting with the, the first of the digital that came. I think Mini DV was there, and after that HDV came, and that enabled the first full HD, 1920, 1080, and I was so excited, and I would be doing the tests, and also taking the film print from the HDV footage, full HD upgraded to 2K, and then taking a printout. And it was a fascinating time trying to figure out, how close can we match up with film. But Alexa happened 2010, 11 onwards. And it has changed.
And then things changed completely after that.
Completely.
Okay, I'm going to go back to you, Savita. I'm going to, I saw this very interesting interview with you where you talked about, you were talking about the references or the influences that you had. And you very interestingly talked about literature. You said that, I was very intrigued by the fact that you said that literature has an influence on you. And I was very intrigued by that because literature is always about words. It's about writing. And writing is fascinating form because it makes you imagine things in your mind. There's no image in front of you. It's not like a picture or a piece of art or a photograph, but you have to then use your imagination and your mind to think of something. And I was wondering whether you wanted to talk a little bit more about that and maybe with an example, I don't know.
So I think literature, I think all of us, like as artists, no matter if you're a writer, director, or sound designer or any other artist, I think it's literature is food for us, right? It gives us the worldview to see the world and to imagine it. And like you correctly said, that we eventually, what is the job of a cinematographer? It's to bring a script alive, to decode it, and to give it that unique visual language. So So very early on, like when I started doing cinematography, I mean, I was also like any other student caught up in this whole, microscopic world of wanting to do one shot correctly, light that one shot beautifully, then the other one. It takes you a little time to understand that, it's not about one image per se, it's about seamlessly telling that story. So that is where the real challenge lies. And literature in that sense, for me, right from the beginning, especially Hindi literature, because I come from the north and I really admire what our writers have written. So I remember as a kid reading those books and making my own films in my head, and I was visualizing them, and I was blocking them, and I was lensing them and composing them. So that kind of made me a visual person, even though it was starting from words. And of course, I was watching cinema, but I've always been more drawn to the content, the context and the story and where the weight comes from in the story. So that holds a very special place for me. In terms of literature, I just recently made a short film, which is like my first film as a director. And there's this, all the writers that I've been influenced with in a way, like the ones who kind of inspired me, people like Vinod Kumar Shukla, Krishna Baldev, I mean, somewhere I found myself going back to those references, and it helped me design and write and imagine my film the way I wanted to. So, yeah, that's what.
Thanks. I'd like that was to that say. Was wonderful. That whole description of you blocking things based on a description in a novel was actually quite fascinating. Okay, I'm going to move to Maheen, and we'll come back. We'll all come back to, you know, having a conversation again. Maheen, I loved watching Turup. I saw today was spent catching up on everybody's work as much as I could, and there's so much more that I still have to catch up on. And congratulations. And I really identify with the idea of the collective, because I myself started my own career as part of a women's collective called Media Storm in 1986. We were six women and we made three films on religious fundamentalism. And I know what, you know, what it means to be part of a collective. So my question for you is that, and the, and of course your collective, Ekthara, is a step in that direction. And my question to you is that, what does a collective do to you as a practitioner, as a cinematographer? What does it give to you? And how does it, for the want of a better word, how does it overshadow your work as a, because after all, you're also a, you know, you're also a technician, you're also a craft, actually the technician is a wrong word, you're also a creative person who works in her own right. So, you know, how does it work for you to be in a collective?
Right, thank you. I think to start with, I would just like to define, not define, but speak a little bit about the collective itself, because it's a little different, because it is not a homogeneous set of people. It's not people who belong to the same caste, same class, same gender kind of a thing. It is a group of people who is very diverse. And the whole idea of why this thing came together was primarily because what the mainstream was offering to us were stories that were about others, or being told about others, or in which we were either stereotyped or we were othered. So the whole idea of coming together was to tell our own stories. And if we had to tell our own stories, then we would have to be those many people, because we comprise a large part of the world, as women, as trans people, as Dalit people, as people from different religions, not mainstream religions. So, and we have our own stories to tell, and in the way in which probably we are not being able to, in which people are not able to tell them, because we are not there. So I guess like all responsible people do, we just decided that, okay, let's just take matters into our own hands and start to work on this. And in terms of practice now, just having given that much of context, in terms of practice, what I have felt very strongly is that there is this the concept of the gaze, which we all as practitioners grapple with. I feel being a part of this collective and working, the gaze of the film is very, very enriched because of the kind of backgrounds and identities that people come here with. We don't have to struggle to bring in a female gaze. We do not have to struggle to look at how Adivasi people view the mainstream. We do not have to struggle with how do we look at sexuality, which is different from the usual heteronormative. So I feel that it has given me an opportunity to be able to bring in visuals without struggling to really capture something in a certain way. It's already there. It's just supposed to be put forward. The other thing I feel is that, and I think that it could be better explained with an example, is that we've always been used to, even when we are trained, we are taught a particular kind of aesthetic, and we tend to superimpose that onto everything that we are trying to bring into our work, and also excel at it, mm-hmm. and refine it and make it better. But I think that the other advantage that was there was because of the contexts that were part of the content of what was being shot, that kind of became redundant. That aesthetic kind of became redundant. Because I remember when we were shooting Jadui Machi, we were trying to light up a particular scene. And somebody who was passing by said that aisi wali light to yahan pe kisi ke paas nahi hai. We were trying to have a practical within the shot. Mm. And that is when we started to think about how do you convert light, which is with people who have very little resource to afford it, from being an object that illuminates to becoming something that can also put forward an idea or a dialogue or whatever concept or a scene. And I think that kind of broke down in that, and it hasn't been easy, it's always a struggle, but that kind of broke down my own understanding of how the aesthetic that we are trying to bring forward has to be inspired from within the location or within the people that we are presenting in our stories. And it cannot be something that we bring from our learning and then put... exactly. So that was the other thing. Now, in terms of how does it overshadow? There are two things which I always feel, which I'm sharing because we are having this conversation. One thing is that there's a lot of resource crunch. Sometimes because we are shooting where we are shooting, with the people that we are shooting with, even lenses are not available and they have to be brought. Somebody has to travel to say Bombay or Delhi and they have to be brought. There is not enough resource to be able to get it right always. And that resource kind of, it's also a challenge in the way, and it also kind of encourages you to start to innovate and think about how do you do the same thing with this much instead of with that much. But it does, I feel, affect to a large extent some amount of, it would have been easier. I think it affects the time in a large way, the amount of time that is required to execute something without the resources or without the technology that you would otherwise have easily done with. That, I think, is one thing that I feel does affect the kind of work that one would like to put. I think all of us as practitioners love to be precise, and the precision is something that we all try to bring into our work. And so I think that that has been something that I have always felt. And the other thing is that there is little trained support that is available because of the resource crunch or the time or things like that. So one is always trying to work with people who have never pulled focus to try to explain how to pull focus or to light up a scene or to. So that I think has been something that has affected in the sense, like when you're talking about overshadowed, I think that those are the things those are the challenges that would come. You give some, you take some, you deal with it however you wish to. And I think that being a part of IWCC to a large extent solves a lot of my technical problems because there's so much of just tech talks that's going on there. Yeah.
But I'm glad that you brought up the issue of class, because I think that is so important. And I think that a collective like Ektara is actually dealing with that. And I think it's something which is something important to signpost. I'm going to ask you a question to do with your documentary, because you made a documentary called If She Built a Country. And I'm going to ask you this question because I struggled with shooting my own film, Three Women and a Camera. I wanted to be my own camera person because I was making my own film. Now, I'm talking about documentary. I don't think it's going to be possible with fiction. Maybe it's possible with fiction. I don't know. But I mean, I insisted on doing it, but it was very tough because how do you direct and shoot at the same time? And that's a question I wanted to ask you.
I think to put it very simply, it is one of the things which I find completely impossible to do, because there is always that there is always a visual which is giving a certain amount of information when you are within the environment. If you've seen If She Built a Country, you know that it's been shot in this in this scape where the women are struggling with mining, but and there is that it's very difficult to decide when do you want to say something and when do you want to see something, and I think every and I really feel a lot of respect for people who shoot nonfiction, because I really don't I'm still grappling with how do you kind of come to a consensus on that, you know, within yourself also, because there is that constant dichotomy that and something similar happened when I was shooting Ek Inqilab Aur Aaya for Uma Chakravarti, because it's set in Firangi Mahal, which is this rationalist Islamic and then there are these women who are rebelling within that. So it's something that Amir Khel se sabki la tapkegi, just to be able to shoot something like that. And you do it the best and then you just hope that the editor will take it forward. I'm so glad that we have editors.
Yeah. I'm so happy that you said I actually shot her first film, the trilogy, the first one. But I'm very interested in this question because I remember, struggling with it, because you want people to say some things, but you're also concentrating on the frame as a cinematographer, as the camera person, and so I actually had a friend who did the interviews for me, because I couldn't direct and shoot at the same time. So it's something that I struggled with, and that's why I wanted to ask you that question. So we'll come back to you, Maheen. I'm going to move to Fauzia now. Fauzia, you've shot a number of films in regional, in a number of films which include regional cinema, which includes Malayalam, Bengali, and Tamil. And I want to ask you about your experience with two films in particular. One is, and I'm not sure that I'm pronouncing the film, the name correctly, the Tamil film Uyir. Am I right? Okay. And which has a transgressive plot, because it's about this woman who has an affair with her brother-in-law. But it also is described as an erotic thriller. Now, I'm very interested because it's not the kind of film that a woman cinematographer would be chosen to shoot, because it's an erotic thriller. Somehow I feel like that's an area that they would keep women out, just as I think action, as we'll come to with Priya, is something that people say, oh well, it's a backhanded compliment that they give Priya, saying that it was such a rugged masculine film, and it was a woman cinematographer shooting it, because it doesn't fit their notions of what women can shoot. And the other is a film like Mitra, which you did with Revati, which had an all-women crew. So I just want you to talk about your experience of working on both these films.
To begin with, Mitra, my friend, was my debut work, and Revati had contacted and we worked on that project. Now, when I had my first interaction with her, I got to know that the film is being written by another, Priya had written the film and the dialogues was they were done by Sudha Kongara, and the music was going to be Ilayaraja's daughter, Bhavatarani Ilayaraja. So when I entered the project, there were already these women, crew members, and I was damn thrilled about it. And that, I realized that it's a possibility to get the other crew members also as women, because just coming out of the institute, I was just 2 years out of the institute, and this is 2000, the year 2000. I graduated in 98, and in my batch, there were so many women studying, girl students, that we had to take over the boys' hostel. and there were audiographers and production designers and editors and you name it. I mean, there were so many of us. So I'm coming very fresh from there. And when I feel that, when I felt that, yeah, this these are all women crew members, I felt that an editor and sound is it's going to be damn easy. And I, in fact, suggested to Revati that, Bina Paul, how about contacting her? And so she knew Bina, and that's how the editor happened. And then we looked for the sound person, and Gita happened. So given that scenario of having first, I mean, in institute, I have worked, my director was a Dimchi, I mean, a Vietnamese lady, and, working with a woman director who actually came from a television industry, and I had a certain craft about how she wanted to visualize the work and things like that. So coming from that experience and with this entire women technical crew, it was it just was very simple and easy. I mean, it was just smooth and interacting, discussions, everything. I mean, seamless kind of atmosphere. And the main character in Mitra, My Friend, is this lady who is a homemaker and goes from India and is in the Silicon Valley with her husband. And her entire trajectory of her character, how she is such a dependent, heavily dependent person. And then thanks to the internet of that time, kind of opens up with her friendship. And then finally it resolves into her internet friend also being her husband. I mean, I remember coming up with this thing that, it is a radical thing at that stage to have this lead character to be, venturing out and developing herself and things like that. But then you're not letting her go out too much also. You still keep it into the bounds of, her friend turns out to be her husband. So that was, it was a little difficult for me to digest at that point, but then it's a directorial and writerly craft, and then you try and do the justice to the entire vision of that writing. And so the comfort zone is fantastic. Everybody is doing everything and you're discussing and 24/7 and you're staying together and cooking for each other and looking out for each other. And when we were a small crew of 10 members and we managed to do that project, we shot for a month in San Jose and things like that. Then from there, I to talk about Uyir, many things happened in between. Uyir was my probably fifth or sixth film. And what happened was the director was doing his first film, Uyir's director, and he hadn't had any experience before at that stage. I mean, he hadn't worked on a film project or anything, so he was quite raw, but he had written the work. And the producers were also new. I mean, they were doing their first project. So it was in that kind of situation where I was approached, and their responsibility was that I should be able to, handhold the whole team and make this whole thing happen. So it was not so much about, the erotic part, but that they thought that I would, they mm-hmm. could trust me to make that project, to its fitting end. So I did take it up. I mean, I see it as a contractual obligation, like, yeah, okay, I'm going to do this work. And literally taking on, shouldering the responsibility of the production side as well as the direction side. And then you're kind of, a shadow person doing a lot of work, but which actually goes uncredited. And and another thing was the director's first project it was, and he actually needed me to communicate with the sister-in-law character, I mean, the lady.
Sangeeta.
Sangeeta is a veteran, and she had done a lot of Telugu films and established actor. And he being a complete fresher, he was quite afraid of actually approaching her. And it helped him that I was the DP, that I would go along and in scene discussions and descriptions, and I would be there in right through. And it helped Sangeeta because I was there, and she could kind of trust and completely relax with me. So when the scenes were, you know, so-called erotic, and there was this camaraderie between her and me that would make it as beautiful as we can. I mean, definitely eros is part of life. And then
of course,
how do you not go into, you know, the vulgarity which is intended, but then, you know, or hoped for by the larger so-called, you know, you blame the audience wants it. So it needn't be that. We will make it as beautiful as possible. So actually it was a pact between, you know, the lead actor and actress and Sangeeta and myself. And we worked out the, you know, lighting in such a way that it was more flattering than actually, you know.
That's actually a wonderful, you know, idea of the synergy between the cinematographer and the actor, which I think is fabulous.
It really helped me in another project also, my second film, that was with another mainstream Tamil film. It was with Soundarya, and unfortunately, she passed away in an air crash after a couple of, you know, 2005 or something. So this film was in 2002, and this similar kind of a vibe with the lead lady, which she was actually a prominent role in the film, and it worked out very well, actually. I mean, so I kind of go for, you know, the comfort with the lead actor, and somehow that made me also understand that it might be the case with, say, the big stars, where you have, you know, if one gets into a comfort zone with certain either gender wise or the style of working wise or something, you know, things like that. So I did it in a, you know, contractual way. If you're good to do it, we'll do it, but we'll make it as beautiful as one can do. Yeah.
Okay, Fawzia, I'm going to move to the next question, which is about teaching, because I feel like I need to ask you this question. You know, there's always been this debate about people learning on the job, going to film school. And I know that you have taught at SRFTI, you've been, you know, at Trishti, you've at the Prasad School. And, you know, with cameras getting smaller and smaller, there's, you know, people say, well, okay, people are now making films on the mobile phone. They're making films on DSLRs. Everybody can make films. It's all very democratic. It's all very, you know, hunky-dory and all of that. Where does it take the film school? Is there no need now to teach cinematography any longer? Like, that's my question to you.
Right now, I'm in a film school in Kerala. It is the first state-run film school, K.R. Narayanan National Institute of Visual Science and Arts. And what should I say? And Kerala is a place where, you know, every second person is a film buff, and it's a fantastically connected in film cinema aesthetics wise, and the number of societies that are so active, and the number of people, practitioners. You can see that number of independent films that happen are like three times the film that happened in the industry, so-called four times more films happen, and, you know, first-timers and independent cinema people. So therefore, the film literate state, being a film literate state, there is definitely, you know, there is definite need for formal or organized education. Definitely, it depends on the need of different people are different. I mean, there are people with under circumstances where the shortest course and the shortest time might be the most possible for them to do, and then it makes sense to have that. But then there are students who would be looking at a formal kind of instructions that in a formal environment, in a formal way, and definitely the needs are many, and there is possibility and so many options to fulfill the needs. And therefore, there is definitely a space for a formal film education and a formal film school, because the entire intellectual approach to studying cinema and the practice of cinema is very, very, very much needed in today's time. I mean, that can never be offset or removed.
Thanks for that.
Thank you.
I'm going to move now to Priya, and we'll come back to you, Fawzia, again. Priya, you have done some, you have an awesome command over many films, a very wide range of genres. You've shot, you know, three very big, you know, blockbuster Bollywood films, and I'm sure there are many more in the pipeline. And they've all got a very distinctive look. So whether it is, you know, Chef, which has this
very glossy ad-like kind of sensibility to Ara Anna, which I tremendously enjoyed watching. I somehow missed it. And then the gritty realism of Airlift, which is one of my very favorite films. And, you know, it's, as I said, each of them have this very distinctive look, which is clearly the mark of a successful cinematographer, so that you don't look the same in every film that you shoot. And you have, you know, you're very much a mainstream. You're somebody in the mainstream. You're there and competing with, you know, everybody else in the mainstream. So I just wanted to, I mean, there's so many questions that I can ask you, but I'm going to just ask you about the long takes and the staging of action in Airlift, which, you know, we showed the long takes in Airlift. I show it to my students. And, you know, so I just thought that maybe you might want to unpack for us, since we are talking about practice, you know, just this whole idea of how do you actually stage something like that, when what goes into staging action when you're doing something which is on that kind of scale. And you can take any sequence from the film and describe it.
First, I just want to say thank you for telling me that, because when you sent the mail earlier to me and you said you discussed that in your class at Jamia, it completely made my day, because I think those are things that what carry us forward, you know, a little work here and there, all that is fine, but this is super thrilling. So thank you for that. And I think, you know, I'm actually in the middle of prepping another action film at the moment, which goes on to the floors in April. And again, it's with the same director, as Raja Menon. It's a film called Pipa. It's based on the 1971 Bangladesh War. Oh. And so there's action, and then there's action in this one. So it's, I think, far more elaborate in that. And I've just come back from Recce yesterday. And this is the conversation we keep having about how do we see action? Because we've clearly realized that there is something in the gaze that we share towards action, which is a little bit unique and a little different in terms of how we like to tell the story through action. And in Airlift, I think one of the very important things that we had decided earlier on is that we are not going to glamorize action. We are not going to sensationalize it. And it's not because we have some moral value judgment on violence. It was not about that. But that didn't seem like the way we wanted to tell the story, the story that we were telling. Mm. Action was just, you know, it showed up and it left in the film. And that was the whole point of it. You know, it wasn't that, okay, now let's brace, there's an action sequence and it doesn't fit at all into the rest of the narrative style of the film. So we wanted to kind of just let it go by in the same pace as the rest of the film. So that was a decision we had taken earlier on. So there was going to be, we had not shot any high speed translating into slow motion stuff for the rest of the film. So it wasn't going to happen in the action. So we kept tying our hands up little by little and saying we are going to remove things from our arsenal and only use what we have done consistently over the film in terms of tools. So that was, I think, the beginning of it. And then if there was a particular action sequence that we were going to kind of get into, it had to be from the point of view of where the story was being told at that point. So the camera would only be where it was for the story, and we would shoot the action and make it work from that perspective. So again, that was another thing that we put down. You know, we're not suddenly going to get into gratuitous camera shots where there's a low angle somewhere, super wide, where it just dramatizes the action. So we just kept removing things from what we allowed ourselves to work with to tell the story, so that it was, because, you know, the idea that suddenly those action sequences stand out and it becomes this kind of show-off thing about see what all we can do. I think we were both completely against it. And I think it just worked exactly the other way at one level, because I'm very proud of what we did in all of that, but they do stand out. And I think they stand out because they don't stand out.
If you know what I mean. I was going to add, Priya, that there's a sense of the visceral in that sequence, for instance, where you see this guy from the terrace looking at this huge action. Now you could actually show us all of that, but actually we see it from his perspective and we are looking through the bars of the balcony, and it just somehow heightens it, because, you know, you said you feel that sense of fear with this man who's watching what's happening outside.
Yeah, so even, you know, the one I like to talk about is also the other one where Akshay's character Ranjit is, yes, in the car, and yeah, he's that is actually a sequence that is a precursor to another mise-en-scene action sequence. I mean, part of the story where he walks into his house and he finds his wife and child missing. Yeah. And we knew that sequence, we had actually shot the second sequence first.
where he walks in, and we did that actually without rehearsals. So we didn't plan it at all. We got the soldiers in the film, you know, they broke the set down, they did all of that, and then we just locked the set and we kept a hot set. And we didn't let Akshay come in and rehearse or do anything. Raja literally went to him in his vanity and he was like, the soldiers came to your house and they destroyed it, and you're going to walk in and see your wife and child missing. So come running from the vanity and enter the set, and Priya's handheld, and we're going to shoot this. And we had one take to get it right, and that was it. And he literally just ran into the studio and into the set and then just made that space his own. And all I was doing, it was like actually like a dance, because I had no idea what he was going to do. And we were just dancing around each other constantly. But it's so beautiful. And I think when you have people where there is so much synergy in terms of the way you're telling the story, and he really was in it at that moment, and so was I. Because there was no third person, because we were going 360. Focus puller was out, everyone was out. I had someone just spotting me from the back. And we really did just dance around this entire set and react. And I think I was acting as much as he was, because I was kind of reacting to him. So that was a sequence we had already shot. And we knew that we had got that, and it was beautiful and heartbreaking. But we didn't want to kind of get into this big fat action sequence right before that, because he was vulnerable at that point. He's going home and he doesn't know if he's going to find his wife and child. He was heading, and this was the drive home. Now, suddenly, if we get into this, let's put the camera everywhere and see this bomb happening and someone getting shot. I think you just take away from what you're trying to do is be in his head at the moment. So we figured that the only way to be in his head is to just close up the car. And we'd staged this massive street by then, you know. We took that call the night before the shoot. We're like, this is just looking wrong. Let's lock ourselves in that car. Let's put the windows up. And let's just watch what happens from his point of view. He's trapped in this space. He's completely, you know, so that was the way to do it. And again, to stretch time and slow it down without actually just shooting slow motion. And, you know, so we tried to do that with the way the camera was moving and the way people were moving. And so it unfolded again in bits and pieces. And I think that's something we like to do, you know, just unfold it as it's happening, because that's how you would see it. You don't see it out of order. And I literally felt like we were just like draining him at one level, you know, just literally taking everything out of him, and then he finds they're gone. So I think it leads one into the other. And so that's how that happened. We did 5 takes of that. We rehearsed for the whole day. Between 4 and 5, we did 5 takes, and I think got it on the 4th.
That's just fabulous. Thank you for that description. That's amazing. And you can be sure that that's going to go into my glasses for sure. Okay, so the next question is, of course, the obvious one. You are the underwater, cinematographer, one of the few people in Bombay. And I'm sure you've been asked this question millions of times before, but I have to ask this question. So, you know, when you're looking at underwater stuff, I mean, one of the films that has become very popular on Netflix is My Octopus Teacher. I don't know whether you've seen it, but with Craig Foster. And it's mesmerizing to watch. But obviously, it all looks, you know, just effortless. And it's not. It's not effortless. There's so much that goes into planning, you know, what's happening when you're underwater. So I just wanted you to talk a little bit about that.
I think, you know, that's with filmmaking in general, right? The whole idea is to pare back your craft and make it look effortless at the end of the day. And I think if you start seeing the effort in any of it, I think then we fail as filmmakers. And in underwater cinematography, I think the effortlessness is even more, just because it's kind of floaty and all of that stuff. But it is, I think that is the part of cinematography where the physicality of it does come into play, you know. And as I don't know who was saying that earlier, that cinematographers are all bodybuilders, then you said that, sorry, then, you know, best cinematographers will be bodybuilders. But I think the physicality of it does come into play a bit with underwater stuff, even though as effortless as it looks, we're actually battling, you know, really heavy housings underwater, and the resistance of all of it. You know, we're lighting and shooting, you know, I don't shoot documentary work underwater where I take the camera into the sea and get to do all of that. You know, this is like heavy lifting action sequences, cars crashing, all of that kind of stuff. So I think a lot of the prep for that does, because there's no precedence for this, you know, pretty much all the work that we're doing in underwater work world over, pretty much whatever's happening is happening for the first time because it's new, it's a new part of cinematography. So the preparation is the earlier jobs that you've done, and the learning is from earlier jobs that you've done. So, it's distracting to see my own face. I'm seeing Gaddy. Can you see Gaddy again? Because it's so.
Yeah. I'm just coming back to gallery view. I've just kind of gone off gallery view.
Oh, you did. Else. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
No.
Yeah. So I think the prep for that is now literally, I've been doing this, I think, 12 or 14 years underwater cinematography. And I think what I've ended up doing is I'm far more meticulous about the notes I make. And it's not so much about the prep for myself, but every time we shoot underwater, it is about educating the team that I'm working with because it's new. You know, most people haven't shot underwater. Like, so it's just to explain how this works and how, and I think what you mentioned to me is saying that it's like a studio, you know, so I have to keep reminding people it really is like, this is not some deep dark world, which is completely mysterious. Let me break it down for you. Like you have a studio above water. We have a studio underwater. Mm. Our tools are very different, but we're going to try and do similar things with what we do. It's really actually quite complicated to explain. But yeah, so I think the prep work really is the experience of doing every previous job. And the more jobs you do, because the variables are so many, you know, the thing with doing work above water is that at least I know that the air has a certain consistency and quality. And I know when light hits it, what's going to happen. The big part about shooting underwater, which actually throws us every single time, is the clarity of the water. And it's something you have no control over. So the way light behaves underwater actually is something that I'm battling from the beginning of the day to the end of the day, because water is cleaner in the beginning, might get dirtier. Backlight behaves very different. So it's a dance that's happening all the time to make it look consistent, because water does not behave consistently over the span of even a 12-hour day. So yeah, it's a tricky one.
This is a very unsatisfying conversation, because
I know.
Long conversations with any of you, and that's yeah. kind of frustrating.
Yeah.
So one more quick question, Priya, because I'm going to add one more on to you.
Yeah.
Have you ever shot virtually, and you know, have you done virtual shoots? And I know that, and I'm asking this question because of COVID, but I think I saw an interview with you somewhere where you said that even before COVID, you had done something virtual.
Actually, yeah, it was actually in the thick of COVID, like lockdown. It was in April. There was this Dettol commercial that suddenly came up and they wanted to release something or the other. And what we had done is the only place at that point which was open, because the world was closing down at that point. And the country that hadn't closed down, and the producers who they managed to literally like spot Bahrain, which was just out of the blue. And we had set up this remote shoot in Bahrain in April, I think, where that time you could still go out and five people cruise. Like they were just about. So it was like literally just slipping under the door and doing the last shoot. So now it's become quite standard. You know, this whole putting it up on Zoom and seeing, you know, you watch the entire shoot. But it threw me off completely at that point. But what we did end up doing, which worked really well for us, is we had a lighting day, which was fine. And we had set up cameras all over on the shoot with backstage cameras. So... And I think, you know, this is where being meticulous in your prep generally really works and really helps, because I think I knew it's like, okay, there's a window there. Now put that light at 5 feet. Okay, that's a 6K. Now move it 2 feet to the left and you should get a reading about this much. Is it this much? Okay, yeah, we're not really off. And I think documenting the work that you do constantly and making it like homework, and I do that a lot actually, even after a shoot sometimes, like, okay, let's make a lighting diagram and let's use it and save it. So I think that really helps, because at a time like that, we didn't have the luxury of firstly going in and doing a lot of changes. We didn't have a crew that actually understood what we were doing a lot. They were just following instructions on a camera. You know, it's like, okay, move that light. Yeah, okay, now let's, that light on Zoom kind of looks correct, but I have no idea. But we didn't have, again, the luxury of watching stills. Like I kept telling them, send me stills and I'll approve, couldn't do it. So it was literally on a wish and a prayer and hopefully, you know, past experience saying that it should work. But really, I think what saved me is that meticulous diagram making year in, year out, day in, day out, and plotting it with, you know, lights and stuff like that. And then learning to visualize, you know, I think we must do that more and more, because I think that is what will make us more precise and take away a lot of time. At the end of the day, you know, it's expensive. Lighting time is expensive. We're getting less and less of it. So if you can go in there, just put your light down and know exactly what you're doing, And I think hone it is an instinct as opposed to a computer generated program. And just, you know, work on that. I think that's what saved me on that shoot.
Okay. So I'm now going to go around with two rounds at least of questions, which I'm going to ask all of you or as many of you want to respond to. So my first question is about camera work. And camera work is always seen as a profession that is both creative and technical. So it's physicality, you know, there's a certain relationship with the body, and there is imagination in your head, of course, you know, it's a vision. And sometimes you can have both combined, and sometimes, you know, you could be, for instance, the operator, and then somebody else's vision kind of kicks in. So what are your thoughts on that? I mean, just a quick response to that. Anybody, whoever would like to go first.
Okay, I'll take it.
Yeah.
I think since we just ended up with that and the physicality of, I think, you know, underwater.
Right.
You're
right.
Talking about progression for that. That what happens sometimes, and I think when you're doing handheld work and when we're doing, you know, the physicality part of it, I think I think the creative work does come a little earlier than that. And then I think I'm actually trying to decode my thoughts as we're speaking. And I think the translation of that through the body, and I think handheld work, I'm just going to take a part of it because you brought that up. I think that becomes a very interesting part for me. And I feel sometimes, you know, when I'm taking a shot and the operation just isn't working out, you know, it feels wrong and it just keeps feeling wrong and wrong. Very often I literally take the camera. I think a bunch of us do that. It's just like, just give me the camera now. And you take it on your shoulder. And I think that's when it just literally becomes part of you, and that expression of the operation then becomes one with your physicality. And I think that then I think it sings true sometimes. When I'm struggling, I end up doing that.
Muted. I was going to just ask Maheen to step in here because am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah, Maheen, because, you know, I'm just thinking to myself that just the obverse of what I asked with the, you know, shooting your own film is that when you're a camera person and you have to, now you're making your film and you're the director and you have to then explain to the, let's say you've got another camera person for you, would you be able to do that? Because you have a certain vision, and it's exactly what Priya is saying, that sometimes you get so frustrated because you know what you want, but you know, somebody else has to operate that camera for you.
Right. I think that there are two things that I find kind of help me in translating, you know, your eyes into your work. One is that mostly in most lens-based practices, people have a kind of an idea of the of what goes in and what is out. I mean, there is always the frame that is that we use as a reference. So usually what happens is that for the kind of work that I've mostly done, or even the kind of work that I would like to do, is that there is some amount of action that is anyway already happening. And that action needs to be framed in a certain manner. And what has not worked for me actually is when you try to have a frame and then put in the information of the action within that. Constantly there is there is a contradiction in that. It kind of gets into your way. So to be able to frame around the action and to be able to explain that the world has to kind of come together within that, you have to make the world fit into that frame rather than making, you know, like the other way around where you're trying to push everything into your frame. That is something that I think that is a conversation that came to me also with some amount of practice. And I think it works very well for documentary. It also works when you're working with people who don't understand the technical language of And the other thing I think that has really been helpful is that because there is so much of proliferation of imagery that we are all constantly bombarded with, cinematic language is constantly changing and very, very fast. So people actually kind of are able to recreate grammar for you. And I think that what we also need to do is to step back and try to learn that language, because I don't think that we are reading films the way we used to do it even 3 decades ago.
Sure.
It's gone through a full change and a full shift. So I think that is another thing that has helped me to try to learn from what we are getting in terms of imagery, because now the non-experts also have access to that. And that is why I think digital has, for me at least, because for most of us, it was very niche when it was film. And it was only when digital came in that a lot of us got access to it. And so I would still consider that something that has been an advantage for us. And of course, this changing language of cinema, it always excites me to think that tomorrow is going to be different.
No, these are two very important points. And I was just thinking that technology has made so much of a difference. I mean, if you think of all the different kinds of accessories that we have today, you know, your drones and jibs and, you know, all kinds of stuff. And it has actually changed the grammar and it's changed the language and everything can look so different. It's going to lead me into another question related to the one that I asked, you know, about the imagination. And I just wondered whether all of you would quickly like to talk about your own what kind of references do you draw from? I know that Savita has actually addressed this in terms of literature, but, you know, I'm sure that there are other references. Maybe you just feel that you don't really draw from references. So I know, Priya, for instance, in Airlift, you talked about a photograph from Kuwait. And I thought that was a fascinating example that, and I, you know, I'm thinking of the tones of the film. And I think that, you know, it's so amazing that you should talk about perhaps a documentary photograph, maybe that was the reference.
Yes.
So would you like to all go through something that, maybe you can give me an example of something that has been a reference for you for a particular sequence or a particular film. Anything, you know, whatever. Savita, would you like to go first?
So I
Hi.
So the referencing, I think, is happening all the time. And it's been happening right from the start. So like, even if it's a cafe you are at or a restaurant you're dining at or a theater or a backlit street or dimly lit street or the way the sun is falling or how people are looking in a certain light. So you keep storing all of that in your head and you keep, I mean, there's a joke, like a lot of people who are friends with DPs always tell them that you never stop looking at light. I'm sure all of us do it. Yeah. So, and apart from that, for me, paintings have been like studying paintings, the theory of color, also looking at photographs, real photographs of like I really visit Magnum Photos a lot. Like I really enjoy watching work of photographers across the world and how are they shooting their subjects and how is the space playing out in that, and films, cinema, of course. But I feel like it's never specific. There could be one image or one idea that you sometimes attach. Sometimes it's music for me. Like for example, when I was shooting my short film, there was this one particular track which I would play all the time on the set or in my head, and that helped me have a rhythm to how I wanted the camera to move or what was the pace of the film. So it's many things, and it's happening all the time according to me. So, yeah.
Priya, would you like to say something about that?
I think Savita said it so beautifully, actually, because it is that, right? We do, from like every living moment, it is a reference at the end of the day. So I always find that it's, and you're right, you know, cinematographers don't stop. I think it's hard to, because it's not a job, you know, you don't switch it on, and like filmmaking is not a job, really. We don't switch it on and switch it off. So from the minute you wake, I think the minute you're filing away every single thing. And I think maybe for a particular job, you find some inspiration somewhere to kind of narrow your focus. But life, I think, is reference. And I just find films as reference for films just being too pat, you know. I just, it's
narrow.
Like, yeah. So I can never look at a film and say, okay, I'm going to reference that film for this film. It's too obvious, and I think it's just too narrow. Mm-hmm. And that's the whole point. You glean from everywhere and anywhere, and it could be music, it could be a restaurant, something you've eaten, a smell. And I think that's what's exciting about it.
Ozia, would you like to add to that?
I would just say each film process is different, and it's a process. I mean, you just kind of wait for some epiphanic, you know, element, and then you grab hold of it, and then you float. Yeah. I mean, that's about it. It's a process. Yeah.
So Fawzi, I'm going to ask you the next question, and then we can go back to the others. So, you know, today the cinematographers always worked with the set designer, with the choreographer, especially when you're talking about, you know, fiction, for instance. And you're looking at Bombay Cinema, then there's the dance choreographer, there's lighting, there's, you know, the set designer, the art director and all that. But now, of course, there's the colorist, and, you know, there's a whole new arena of people who come added on. So what does it leave you with as a cinematographer? I mean, do you feel kind of, you know, a lot of cinematographers feel that they lose control. And I just wanted to ask about that.
It would begin with the initial, relationship with the main crew members. And once that synergy is there, then one is not really worried about, you know, whether how much control or... So you're just getting into the entire, pre-visualizing and what is the feel and look you want to have, and let that guide you. And that comes from possibly the script or something, that discussions with the director, or some kind of a framework which you work on. And then I feel that as long as the communication is clear between everyone and you share the vision and this is where we are all headed, then you're kind of okay, as long as, you know, maybe compared to earlier times, it's much more communication dependent and much more transparency element and building of trust and things like that. It's become more dependent on that. I wouldn't really talk about, you know, the technology, or it's not that entirely. It is the workflow that you set out with, and how you engage with people and carry this whole process forward.
Savita or Priya, whoever would like to go next.
Could you repeat your question? Like, I lost.
You know, Savita, I'm just talking about the relationship that you have with the, you know, when you, I mean, now with digital, it's you shoot something, and then, of course, there's the colorist, and you... Obviously, you know, you're working, you have to keep a check on what's happening to your, after all, it's not the finished product, no? It undergoes a certain kind of change. So with digital, so that's what I was asking about.
So the coloring was, the process of coloring was there even in times of film, but we had limited control.
Yes, much more limit. Yes.
A few values. So that has changed. It is both empowering, and it's also at the same time, because the factors are changing. So you have to be, so initially it was very confusing for us. Like the first few DIs were confusing, but now I think it's because the DOP is present for color correction. So, and you have a very organic relationship. A colorist is as much as a part of your team. So again, like you work very closely and you watch the film, you discuss the palette, and there is a thought behind it, and that's communicated. So I don't see that as a thing, but yeah, definitely with the VFX getting more and more now, that is where the image is changing. Like you would shoot something on a green screen, you might have a previs, you might know that this is what is going to come. But a lot of times, you know, later on, it may just not work and something else would change. So, at that time for a cinematographer to still be an author of the image, like you have to really, you know, make sure that image, your image and all the changes that is going through, especially in the post-production and VFX, you have to very closely monitor it. And it's not just when you're shot and it's over, you have to be a part of that whole thing till the end and make sure that you integrate the VFX department and how they are looking at your backdrops and how you've shot your subject, and make it seamless and happen. So that is a challenge, yeah. But it's also getting smoother with time, I'm sure.
Yeah. Maheen or Priya, would you like to respond to that before we move to our last question for today?
Yeah, so to, you know, I'm going to talk about the collaboration part of what you mentioned and production designer, as you said, et cetera, et cetera. And I think it's, and with going up to Savita and saying the VFX supervisor, I mean, sorry, VFX becoming such a large part, the film I'm just thinking is massively VFX. Mm-hmm. And I, it's not so much a question of whether I have authorship over that image, but I think what one has to do is to find a collective vision in this as well, so that we're all on the same page from the beginning. So communication is becoming very important, you know, because at the end of the day, it isn't only my vision at the moment, because there is so many VFX elements coming in. They have a far better understanding of that than I ever will. I need to step up my game as well in terms of understanding what they're going to be doing. So I think, you know, so I think the point right now is to really find that communication so that you find that singular vision in the beginning. And then whether it's mine or theirs or shared or everyone's, at the end of the day, if that vision is correct and we can come upon that, then I think we're in a good space.
Okay, I'm going to move to the last question, which of course, I think it's difficult to end this session without without a reference, and I can see Fauzia smiling, without a reference to the formation of the Indian Women's Cinematographers Collective, which is, to my mind, it's, I'm going to sound like a kid now, mind-blowing. It is amazing. And it's a part support group. It's part union, to my mind. And it brings all these different women together. I'm so privileged to be part of it as well. And it gives me so much, you know. But I want each of you to tell me what it gives to you, what you take away from this collective. And maybe Fauzia can begin, because Fauzia, you can briefly tell us about the formation in very, very short, of course, because we're running out of time. But I want each of you to talk about what you take away from this.
I will just, very, very simple, I will just tell about the formation. It is about self-realization of each person not being alone, and there are more like us, and actually reaching out and networking. You know, it is just the realization, and collectives happen when many people realize the same thing. And I should say that when I reached out to a couple of friends are here, Deepthi, Priya and Savita were one of, you know, and Pooja Gupte, and there are a bunch who we had started contacting right in the beginning, and each person contacting other people. And then, you know, it just kind of, it was just flowering, you know, people reaching out to the other. And, you know, when we began on the day one, we were, I thought I knew 8 people, and then it turned out to be each person knowing 8 more like that. And by second day, we were like 40. I mean, that was, you know, the most, you know, beautiful beginning of the collective. And very fast, people were connecting with each other. And it was as if the need was so evident, and it was there for everybody, and it made sense, and the collective was formed and born, whatever you say. And to me, what it means is that I have said many times about this, my day begins with looking at, you know, what's going on in the group, and you get, like, you know, you start the day with that, and then in between you keep checking. I mean, It is so integral. It's become so part of every day. And there is such a lot of sustenance and energy that comes from it. Though it needn't be something individually that we are associated with, but then you see what others are doing and their concerns and their achievements and their successes and their worries. And there is somebody else who's, you know, responding and, you know, sharing and things. It is so beautiful that it just reaffirms the faith in humanity and sisterhood, and basic trust between people is possible. And there is no, thankfully, there is no factor of finance in this whole thing. I mean, there is no fee, membership, I mean, no structure. No, it's not. I mean, everyone is equally valuable in the collective, and we have just kind of escaped the framework of money and finance and all the formalities. So it's a very liberating act that we have all we are all indulging in and get sustenance from. It's very liberating actually, and I'm so grateful for each person in the collective, each and every cinematographer. Yeah,
thank you Fawzia. Savita.
For me again, IWCC is it's doing beautifully. It's a beautiful space. There are so many women and very, very good, you know, like, and I take so much pride when I meet people on sets, and it's something which we've all heard that, oh, I'm seeing a woman DP for the first time, you know, like us, or they just say, oh, I've only worked with Priya, I only know this one. So I tell them that wait and watch. There's like an army of really killer women on the way, and they're going to take over this place because they're really good. And a lot of them are doing great work. It's a great support group. People can ask any questions, technical, legal. There are like so many newer little apps and cameras coming in, you know, like the younger ones, like I learn so much from them, man. Like I'm blown by their knowledge. And it's like sharing both ways, and it's a safe space for everyone. And I'm very glad that this happened and all of us got together. And there's like one of the most beautiful things about it is that there is no hierarchy. There is no, everybody's equal. Everybody's can come and raise any kind of questions, and they don't have to worry about it. So it's a lovely space, and I'm very happy to be a part of it.
Yeah. Thanks, Mahin. Or Priya, whoever would like to go first.
Okay. I think I must be one of the youngest, I mean, like most recent entrant into the, but it was, I mean, it's the same thing that everyone says. It's like this great support group. For me also, I often feel like a voyeur because, you know, like there are these women who are talking about like these really fantastic cameras and whatever is coming in, because sometimes you're also you also want to know what is happening in and around, and there are people who have access, women who have access to that, and they're talking about it. So you know, you also feel like a voyeur. And I mean, generally, it's like I think what is most for me, what was really wonderful was like, you know, it's like that time when you know you kind of suddenly come to a realization about your own sexuality, and you feel you're the only one in the world, and then you suddenly realize everybody's like crawling out of the woodwork.
There's a world out there.
Yeah, and it was like it's exactly like that, and it's like really wonderful. It's Fawzia said, and thank you to all of those women who got this thing together. And yes, it's just a space which I think we all enjoy. It's lovely to talk about all the technology. Priya, can I just say this? I hope I'm not. She keeps sending these images of her light diagrams and all of that. And that in itself is such a wonderful resource, you know. Yeah. And people talk about their experiences of like, you know, how did they crack this thing about the camera, and how did they like make this work? It's wonderful.
Priya,
well, I think they've pretty much covered everything. I'd just like to say, you know, at the end of the day, as creative people, I think everyone's a little fragile, because that's what creative people are. And we like to be nurtured, and we like to be coddled a bit. And I think that's a large part of what the collective does for every member. You know, there is a sense of being held. And if you're feeling slightly, you know, vulnerable at some point, some people go through some crises, you know, there is a place that you can reach out and you will be acknowledged. And whatever it is, it could be, again, as you're saying, you know, it could be from legal to technical to technological to personal. I've heard these motherhood discussions on it. It really is that, you know, it is that whatever it is, you will be held here. And it's a safe space, and it'll, you know, people will try and work as much as they can to make it okay. And I think, so if all of that is held, then I think the creative work comes from there. It's not necessarily that we're only dealing in creative work, you know. But that sense of security and belonging, where you feel safe, to me is actually one of the biggest parts of this collective.
I think you put it so well. I made a little list for myself of all the things that I found, but I'm not even going to say that, because you just put it all together so well at the end that now all of that is going to seem very trivial, you know, things like putting finding out about insoles and harnesses. And I mean, it's amazing from COVID protocol to health issues to like, what do I do for exercise to for my back, for my lower back? I mean, it's all there, but except that you just put it so much nicer. So I'm not going to say any of that. All power to you. And that's what I, that's all I will say to all your amazing stories and all power to you. And with that, I'm going to, you know, hand over back to Subhashree.
Thank you, Sabina. Yeah. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, and thank you all. I'm actually, I just wish I could keep listening to all of you. This has just been such a life-affirming discussion for me. And I mean that, and enriching. But we have to close at some point. But there are questions from the audience, and I think it would be a shame not to actually address them as well. So I'm just going to read out some of the questions, and you all can take answer them. So the first, and also I apologize if my if I stammer words. You know, this screen is at a distance and my eyesight isn't great and I don't wear glasses. So the first question is from Anik De. Hello to all great ladies. So my question is, should an aspiring cinematographer learn a job or attend an institution as a regular person after class 12? What are the basic necessities to evolve the script at a ground level, intuition or director's brief? So I think there are two parts to this question. First is, do you need to attend? I guess that was in some ways, Sabina had addressed that question of, do you need to attend an institution? And I think the second part of the question this person's asking is, how do you kind of realize a script? Is it intuition or the director's brief? And what is the role of the cinematographer in it? Which I also think has been in some ways covered in the conversation, but is it something that any of you would like to take, or otherwise we can move to the next question.
I think it was covered actually.
Yes. Okay.
I think we did talk about a relationship, you know, with the director and their vision, etc.
Okay, yeah. So there's another question that which just give me a second.
It says anonymous attendee.
Yeah, there are many anonymous attendees. So I'm choosing the questions, not in any particular order. Fascinating that many of you have actually ventured beyond boundaries that most male DPs ever feel the need to venture beyond. All of you have made films. Fauzia is also a teacher and cinematographer, also an artist and a commercial pilot, I think, ? Priya is an underwater expert and studio owner. Is there a reason that sometimes women just go that much further, try harder? Is it the response? Is it the response of things not being easy? So yes, do any of you want to respond to that?
Okay, I will.
Yes.
Yeah. Very
Please go
early.
Ahead,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Very early in life, one gets to encounter a lot of frames and within which one needs to fit. Many people, maybe your parents, society, friends, school, all give you a frame, and you, most people, all of us try hard to fit into that frame and do things accordingly and, have terms of reference for success and things like that, which are defined by others. The moment that one realizes that terms of success and, what one needs to do is that framework is set by oneself. And for me, it was like, I decided at some point that, I would set my own framework so that I don't need to blame anybody later on. I am free to make my own mistakes. I am free to learn from my own mistakes. And it's all right if I don't, succeed. It's all right if I fail, as long as it's my mistakes and I'm not blaming anybody. So that decision not to be regretful, or that one hasn't taken a risk, and I didn't want to have regrets. And number two, that I don't want to blame anybody. And these two were the basic factors. And that is what most people always confront, this dilemma. Do you follow your passion, or do you stay bound and within a framework and within a secure, whatever expectation for life? So this is a dilemma that everybody faces. And if one has, prone to taking risk and trying, to find out where your decisions lead you, then you will be surprised, and maybe many good things will happen, and maybe some bad also. But then you just take a decision that you will do your own risk and take responsibility for your own actions and move. so that you don't have to, you know, regret or blame others. So for me, that was the only turning point, actually, when realizing that and moving forward. Otherwise, one can be very secure and safe and look at other people's paths and move that way. I mean, many people take a decision to do that because they don't want to be surprised and they don't want to face insecurities and so on and so forth, which is fine. So that's it. I mean, it's a very individual decision.
And I guess what you're saying is it's also about taking agency, and that begins there.
Yeah.
There's another question from anonymous attendee who asked, this is a common question for all of you. How does your memory of incidents that have happened to you in your past reflect in the way you visualize an emotion or an ambiance in a scene? I mean, I think this is an interesting question.
It has to do with subjectivity, because it's also about what do you bring from your own life. I mean, all this while we've been talking about references which are outside of you. But sometimes I guess that there are things that you draw from your own experience and put that in. And I don't know if any of you would like to answer that, actually.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
It's a great question, but it's just it's a hard one to answer off the bat, actually. But it's a
Fawzia, you were saying something else.
I just want to come to the core of it. You know, the core of this question is not just about our emotions and experiences. It is about truth, how honest we are and how honestly we feel whatever affects us. How deeply do we get affected? And it's the truth about that, you know, the ability to face truth and to hold it. So once you are experiencing whatever happens to you in the truth of the matter, and you're not hiding yourself or, you know, completely experiencing it, then each of your, you know, the moments of truth come in handy when you're looking at, you know, projecting things outside. And you carry that truth with you and you try to be as honest as possible to the scene that you're handling, and because you are trying to come to the truth of it. And that's only, framework within which one can work. You have a reference of what is true, I mean, truth of the emotion of that particular moment.
Thanks. So there's a question from Rajbir Khurana, which has come, I mean, I think it's on YouTube or Facebook, I'm not sure. The Urban Lens social media team has shared. And he asks, what is your take on invisible cinematography and the need to ensure that the camera does not become a manipulator or even a character itself? So who wants to take this?
Is the question really about, I mean, I'm trying to unpack it. Is it about voyeurism? I mean, I'm wondering, is the person actually trying to talk about the camera as being voyeuristic? I wonder. I don't know.
As I understand, it is about, seamlessness. I mean, you call attention to your own work with your lighting and the way you do things, to cinematography. I mean, I think, or you be invisible as a cinematographer. Your work blends with the story so well that it doesn't pop out, stand out.
I think that would be a question of ego, right? Whether your ego as a cinematographer is going to trump what are the demands of the script or the story, and you want to shine more than you want the film to shine. So I think it would be a question of that and how much you hold back.
Right. There's a question by an anonymous attendee. I noticed women in the audiovisual specialization in my college weren't taken as seriously as their male counterparts, even if the women were far superior in their craft and storytelling. How do we break this unspoken conditioning, especially when many women breaking into the field still, when many women are still breaking into the field and can't attend social gatherings, stay out late, participate in drinking, smoking, that it seems as the unofficial bonding process by many. So I suppose it's a kind of social construct this person is asking, but how do we get the chance to do what we do? I think that's, and I think this is again an important question, especially for those who are institutions and colleges. Sabina, yes.
No, Fawzia can then join in. I mean, this is something that I have always felt strongly, and I've always felt this, you know, many, many years ago, this is about 30 years ago.
I wrote it was my first academic publication, like an article in a book, you know, on gender and technology. And one of the things that I had interviewed a number of women, ex-students, you know, who, you know, were women, because in those days, women were encouraged to work on be editors, but not camera people, because, you know, editing was somehow safer, confined space. Camera was out in the, you know, world outside. But, you know, this whole idea of technology, which I brought up earlier, this whole idea of the fog that surrounds technology, how do you learn technology? Technology can be so daunting. And technology is not only learned through teaching. Technology is also learned through these informal networks where exactly what this person asked, where you sit and have cups of tea with, you know, the like persons, with the engineers, the technicians, for instance, in Jamia. And the boys have a, you know, used to have an inherent advantage there because they could just, you know, sit and smoke that cigarette with them. I'm not saying that women can't do it, but it somehow these were social spaces that were available to the men more easily. And those informal networks were also places where people picked up technology. And that is, it is an issue. Absolutely. I mean, I would say that. I don't know what Fozia thinks and what Priya would like to say about that.
Sorry, I'm just going to jump in for a second before Fozia can take over. That's why we have www.iwcc.in.
Love it.
I'll give it up to Fozia.
The only solution is that more women do more of this stuff. That's it. Yeah. There's no other, nobody can help anybody. I mean, whoever wants to work, just persistently go behind it and work.
Yeah.
And that's it. And have faith and confidence in your own ability and don't give up. Just keep doing. I mean, the more of you do, the more of us do, the better. I mean, the ratio changes. That's it.
Yeah. I want to add to what Fozia is saying. I absolutely totally agree with what Fozia has said. I think that if we really want to change the way this whole thing works, is that we allow people who we think are not being treated right or are being marginalized, or they have to populate the sets more. We have to bring in more people who are, because then the whole this fabric of this social gathering also, no, that will also change. It will become different, and we need to break that. There is no other way of doing it. I mean, it's been established over a long period of time, and those things have to change. And the only way we can change this is by populating those spaces. And like the person who has just asked the question, I think she or he should just see to it that there are more women on the set, or there are more, and Dalit people on the set, there are more Adivasis on the set. Just do that and just see the way it changes.
Right. No, I agree. And there are many more questions, but we're seriously running out of time. So I'm just going to read a couple more comments. I know Navroz is also type saying he'd like to share an anecdote about Fozia, but I really apologize, Navroz, we're running out of time. So I'm just going to read a couple of comments and then hand it over to Sabina. Smriti Navatia says, all of you have been fabulous to listen to and see. Thank you, Smriti. Thank you for attending. And the final comment is from Avijit Mukul Kishore, who's a cinematographer himself. He says, this is such a wonderful conversation on diverse concerns with regard to cinematography in its multiple forms and genres. It is opening up so many thoughts, and I wish we could have much longer conversation starting here. I could not agree more with you, Mukul. Look forward to many more. Thanks a lot, Priya, for mentioning the physicality of camera work. Thank you all very much. So I really apologize to everyone else who sent in their questions. Some we've already discussed, but we really are running out of time, and we will have to... Hello?
Yes. Yeah,
close the session. I thought I'd just gone offline. So Sabina, I will hand it over to you. Sabina will make the closing remarks, after which I would really request all of you to stay with us for a few minutes, because this is the last session at the Urban Lens Film Festival. The director of the Indian Institute for Human Settlements, Aruma Revi, will make the closing remarks. So, and I would like to personally thank each and every one of you, Sabina, Priya, Fozia, Savita and Maheen. There's much to think about, and we will be in touch with you to take these conversations forward. Thanks a lot, and over to you, Sabina.
I have very little to say as closing comments, because there's been so much that has been covered in this conversation that I cannot even hope to summarize, so I'm not going to try doing that. I'm just going to raise two issues. One, this whole issue of the female gaze, you know, it kind of slips in everywhere, you know, this female gaze, like that women will look through the camera differently. And I think that this conversation has proved just that they don't look the same. They look differently. It's the other way around, that women will look through the camera because per se they are women, they will look through the camera the same. And they don't, you know, the fact that there are multiplicity of perspectives and that everybody has a different kind of perspective is something that is so evident from this conversation, and that we think differently. And yet our socialization as women makes us conscious of the kind of power structures that we all operate through, and we cannot do away with that. I mean, obviously, that's the reason why we have an organization like the ICWW. The other point that I wanted to make was that I was reminded, and Priya and I were talking about this right before this, and you're going to see this the other way around, but this is a book called Women Behind the Camera, Conversations with Camera Women by a woman called Alexis Krasilovsky, many, many years ago, who came to India to interview women in India. And I think she spoke to Priya, she spoke to me as well. She, you know, did a film as well. But when you look through the book, it's a very interesting book. It has all the pioneers, but it's a book full of names which are women from America and from Europe. And I think it's time now that we have a book of our own, and we, you know, from the subcontinent, maybe not India, but the subcontinent.
Here.
End with that. Thank you very much to all of you for a lovely conversation.
Thank you, Sabina.
Thank you so much.
Can we have the closing remarks, please? Thanks.
I'm Aroma Revi, the director of the Indian Institute for Human Settlements. I'd like to thank each one of you who've joined us from different parts of the globe to make the 7th edition of the IIHS Urban Lens International Film Festival such a resounding success. We watched a sensitively curated bouquet of films from 17 countries in 18 languages that has made Urban Lens a unique opportunity for conversation between citizens, filmmakers, urbanists, and film critics from across the world. I'd like to thank our long-term festival partners, the Goethe Institute, Max Müller-Bøven, and our new festival partner, the Danish Cultural Institute, for the support they provided to make this possible. We hope for a continuing partnership with both of you. The COVID-19 pandemic has made a substantial change in our film viewing practices across the world. Traditionally, a film festival has been about sitting in a dark room, watching a film, and building collective shared experiences of conversation and community. All of this changed in 2020. But difficult moments in history also present opportunities for thinking out of the box and reimagining the existing order. Keeping with this spirit, we decided to go online this year because Urban Lens is a unique international urban film festival where film viewing and conversations take equal precedence. We felt this was an opportunity to bring a wide set of people from across the globe to the festival. The Urban Lens Film Festival is curated by the IHS Media Lab. It started in 2013 to speak to IHS's transformational urban agenda. IHS is an interdisciplinary academic research and practice institution where we engage with the idea of the city through multiple lenses. For us, cinema is an important site through which we engage with the urban. Artists, filmmakers, and writers, through art and different modes of practice, push us to ask important questions about the city and our individual and collective relationship to it. This is crucial because a city isn't just about brick and mortar, but it's a space where ideas, people, communities, and nature are in deep conversation with each other. Cinema is the perfect vehicle to represent the complexity and grittiness of the everyday life of the city. The Urban Lens Film Festival allows space for individual narratives to emerge that can help us contest the homogenization of meaning and identity that's being forced upon us in many parts of the world. The festival is a platform to share and for exchange of ideas and experiences between filmmakers, academics, policymakers, and citizens. We have, over the last 7 years, screened over 150 films from 35 countries in 30 languages at the Urban Lens Film Festival. We've had conversations with directors, cinematographers, editors, and sound persons. you'll find a vast repository of over 100 of these conversations on the IHS YouTube channel. IHS is perhaps the only academic institution globally that curates and hosts a film festival of this nature. With this, we keep our commitment to nurture spaces where film practitioners, cultural theorists, and film critics engage with each other, blurring the boundaries between practice, academia, and film criticism, and of course, across traditional disciplinary boundaries. Many thanks to participating filmmakers who decided to take a leap of faith and agreed to screen their films online. To all the conversationalists who've been so generous with their time and energy and treated us to an excellent set of discussions with film practitioners. To my colleagues in IHS, whose work makes this festival possible every year, and especially my colleagues from the IHS Media Lab, who've successfully put this festival on for 7 years in a row. Thank you, and see you at the 8th edition of the IHS Urban Lens International Film Festival in 2021.